Good morning. That's better. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Good. Carol, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Good. All right. Well, good morning. Praise the Lord. It's good to be here. It's been a while since I've stood here and shared some things. Before we started, I was joking that I finally left puberty and my voice got deeper. I'm actually sick, so. Anyway, when Suzanne sent me a message on Thursday asking me if I could open because neither her nor Tim were going to be here, the first thing that I heard from God that he put in my heart was the prodigal son. So I started thinking about that, and I was reading Luke chapter 15 and trying to listen to things that were coming to me and how to get them all lined up with the original thought that he put in me about the prodigal son. And then we had house of prayer on Friday and some things were said and all that, and I started looking at all that. So I sat down this morning and I started putting some stuff down. And this is what I think I'm supposed to share. We all know that God calls his people. You know, he has a plan for every person, each one of us. It says in the scripture, Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, this is, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. So even before we are thought of by our parents, God has already thought of us.
Exactly.
And he has already chosen something for us to fulfill on this earth. So when we hear this calling, we start this process in which we make what I believe is the most important decision of our lives, and that is choosing Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. If we answer that calling, you know, we cry out to God, he listens to us, and he listens all the time. In Acts chapter 2, verse 21, it says, everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So we start this new life, a renewed life. Now, as children of God, we listen to him, we read, and we study his words, and we start growing spiritually. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 through 17, it says, but as for you, we continue in what you have learned. Let me go back. No, sorry. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Verse 16, it says, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. So as we continue to study God's word, we continue to grow and learn more, have more revelation and all those things, you know, we feel like we're prepared to take on anything. And sometimes because of that, and this is how I was trying to put all this together and how it relates to the prodigal son, because of that, sometimes we can get a little cocky and we start drifting away from the path that he's laid for us. Because even though we have all this knowledge, we still need him as our guide. Mm-hmm. But we get overconfident, we start drifting away. So we lose sight of what's important. One good thing is that we have the Holy Spirit to bring us back. So now I want to read to you Luke chapter 15. It says, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him, and the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.' So he told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." I'm going to pause there for a second. We know that he's our shepherd.
Yes.
Therefore, we are his flock. But as I was saying before, when we get this confidence in all these things that we know, we start drifting away, we become that lost sheep. But we know that he's going out after us. The parable of the lost coin. "Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost.' Just so I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents." When we lose something that is really important to us, don't we get really excited when we find it again?
Mm-hmm.
It's the same thing when one of God's child strays away but comes back. There's the celebration in heaven. And we also get happy and excited as well because that person came back to where they were supposed to be all along. Verse 11, "And he said, 'There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. And no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish here with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate." We know that God is our Father. Even before we were born, he had already chosen us. And he's been waiting for us to come to him. And he's waiting with open arms. So even when we come to him and we accept Jesus as our Savior, we're saved, we get all this wisdom and revelation and we continue to grow as men and women of God, there's a chance that we might steer away from that. But even if we do, there's nothing for us to be worried about, because he's waiting for us with open arms, like the prodigal sons and daughters that we are.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you,
thank you, Lord.
Any prayer requests or testimonies? James.
Prayer for Rita as well. She's got that
things that we did on Friday night on House of Prayer is the Lord put into Sam's heart that we should anoint the flag. And I was thinking about that, also about this message, and I found a scripture, and it's Joel chapter 2, verse 12. It says, "Yet even now declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster." And then down on verse 28, it says, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Even on the male and female servants, in those days I will pour out my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and columns of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Mm-hmm. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there shall be those who escape, as the Lord has said, and amongst the survivors shall be those whom the Lord calls." He's calling everybody. It's just a matter of, are we going to answer that call? Amen. Anyone else?
Amen.
All right. Alvin.
As he was talking about cancer, you know, it's been so long ago, it kind of, you know, you don't think about it much, but back quite a few years ago, I my thyroid started swelling up, and so, you know, I mentioned to my wife, and she, "You got to go to the doctor." Well, okay, I thought that was coming anyway, and so we went, and in about 2 weeks' time, we sent to a fellow to have a sonogram of the done, and and they were about 1 inch in diameter, two solid nodules found. That was about the middle of the month, and of course I was doing therapy, trying to counteract it, and prayer and so forth, and then the things went wild. I mean, a tentacle went up, a tentacle went down, and one went over, latched onto my Adam's apple, and you know, there was quite a bit going on there. And of course, where I was going was a vineyard at the time, and we'd get in prayer for that, and different things, but progressed along, and it felt better. But I decided to go back to original doctor, because the one who's going to got, I mean, she didn't know how to handle things anyway. And gotta have a sonogram of that and a biopsy, you know. And so went in. This was 2 weeks after the first one, and I noticed him just kind of messing around there. He kept working and working. He says, "I don't believe you're a candidate for a biopsy." And he went and called the doctor. Of course, his doctor, you know, he's a doctor. And I said, "I want a biopsy, I want a biopsy." So he kept working and working. Finally, he got enough of a sample to send in. And then, you know, he filled out a report and got to the doctor, and I forgot to get that report from the doctor, because he said, "We got to take him out and then have radiation and radium and whatever, So I went back and got the report, and it said, he said on there, no nostrils found.
Mm. Yeah.
That was 2 weeks after the other one.
Yeah.
But there was a deal. I put heat on it, you know, because heat and cancer don't work too good. And I'm putting heat on it, and I'm about cooking my throat, because the one that left, that tentacle that got over there on my Adam's apple was hanging on for, you know, it just wasn't going to leave. And so that was on Saturday, and Sunday we went to church, and I got prayed for by three different ones.
Mm-hmm.
And faith believing, you know. Monday morning, it was gone.
Amen.
And many times, you know, I just didn't think about it, but you know, these experiences that God moves in, you know, they need to be related once in a while to give Him honor and glory for what He does.
That's right. And,
I haven't had any trouble since.
Amen.
Thank God.
I looked up Myron. He messaged me here a little bit ago. He was planning on being here. They did a skin graft on him Friday night, or Friday. It's taking, but the residual pain and stuff like that he's dealing with. So praying for the total healing for him, and also for Cindy. She was on oxygen most of the night and still doing that coughing thing, kind of like what Jamie has, the upper respiratory arrhythmia. It's going around. It's harvest time, there's a lot of chaff in the air, et cetera, but there's also a lot of unseen things that are in the spirit realm that are coming against my brothers and sisters. So we bind them right now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Right now.
Amen. Anyone else? Yes, Eric.
Well, it's not like a testimony or prayer request. I don't know. I guess I just categorized myself into this. This morning, it was interesting what you were saying. Kind of what God was telling me this morning. A while ago, you talked about redemption. I really enjoyed that. And it's interesting, in the state of Iowa, legally, we have, Iowa is a state where there's redemptions allowed. And it's interesting because if a property gets foreclosed on, because of the farming community, people live off the land, there's what's called the right of redemption. So even after you've been adjudged, okay, and your land's taken from you, you still have a year to pay it back. Even after judgment's fallen, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they can't take it from you until that's happened. Well, so anyone can pay that price, right? Just the price has to be paid, you know, the back fee, and then you get to stay in your land, right? So, you know, say one of us, you know, goes to court, we've had troubles, you know, and we can't pay our, you know, our mortgage. And so we go to court, and then all of a sudden, you know, we're judged off our property. Well, so anyone can come and pay that price. When someone comes and pays that price, guess what? We can go back there and possess and live there. But the thing was, if we won't go back to that land, it doesn't matter if somebody redeemed it for us.
Right.
You see, that's part about redemption we forget.
Yeah.
It's we got to make that journey back to our land, and we got to possess that land, just like what Israel did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, you know? They were stiff and hard, you know, stiff-necked people, right?
Well, right.
You were talking earlier about the rend your heart, not your garment. That's one of my favorite verses. But anyway, that word, the reason that is because the word harden your heart means to veil, means to put a cover over, you see? And so God, Jesus came and paid that price. He redeemed us, but we got to make that journey, right? And our heart's covered by a veil of the self, of the flesh, and that flesh has got to be torn, because that's how we see and hear. In the Old Testament, people couldn't see, they couldn't hear because of that veil of the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesus came and paid the price, and He took care of the veil that was around the Holy of Holies. So He unleashed the Spirit of God.
Amen.
So the Spirit of God can come into our heart, but we got to rip that veil of flesh that's over us, right? And so this ties into what you were saying about the prodigal son. Now, the prodigal son, why does it say he sinned against his father? He just went off and partied. But how did he sin against his father? You see, what happened was he was a son. So what it means to father, when Jesus says, don't call anybody your father, right? Except the good one, you know, he's in heaven, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's because the word father means to come out of. It means express the genetics of. It means to grow into, to turn into. Well, the reason the son sinned against the father was because of him manifesting his father, okay, carrying on the family business, building spend it on himself. It was for him to further what his father was doing. It was for him to carry on and increase and multiply, you know. And so what the son did is he went to spend it on himself. So he manifested himself, not the father. And so that's what, you know, Jesus, God's calling us to do is to manifest him.
Exactly.
And that's what we're supposed to be, as a manifestation of God. Okay, so God is the Father. We're supposed to grow into his genetics, and that's what Jesus was, and that's why it says, you know, that he was the fullness of the Godhood was in him. He was a full manifestation of God. Now, Satan, you know, it's really not mentioned in the Bible that much. It talks about the Antichrist in Revelation, right? Well, so it says that we either were for him or against him, right? So either we're manifesting our Father or we're not manifesting our Father. It's that simple.
Right.
And we, if we're not going to manifest God, if we're not going to tear the veil of flesh, we're not going to see God, right? Like Jesus did, see him, hear him, and, you know, and then be equipped for good works through the power of the Spirit. I mean, what good is it? What good is it to sit with the confession and have no good works? Because that's how we manifest the kingdom. That's what we're supposed to do, is to go out and be Jesus of the world.
Amen.
And it's so sad that we'll sit in church and we'll you know, it's almost like we prove we're dysfunctional because we minister within our own body, but we're not getting out and functioning.
Yeah.
You know, so that's a sign of our own dysfunction, our own lameness. You know, God calls us to get out and start manifesting our Father. And that's how we'll see Jesus.
Yes.
You know, it's not because we have a positive confession, because we got a fish bumper sticker, you know, and, you know, one way or whatever. You know, it's because we are, you know, who we're supposed to be. But on the same hand, the enemy wants to manifest himself in us,
sure.
You know, through the works of the flesh, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it says put away those things. So there's two ways to do it. One way we can put, that we can manifest God, is that we go towards the Father, and so we become more like good. The other way, at the same time, we're supposed to go away from evil, right? And be, I mean, and it's not us doing it. It's the Holy Spirit. But he wants to do two things. He wants to draw us in relation to God, but he also wants to pull us out of who we were.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right? And so when the Son returned, he was coming out of who he was,
mm-hmm.
You see. And so anyway, you know, with everybody being sick, it just makes me think about, that's what Satan wants to do. He wants to trick you, deceive you, and then he wants to manifest himself in you, and not just in our actions, but also in our health. He wants to steal, rob, kill, and destroy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's just so imperative that we just yield to God, pick up the cross daily so that we kill the flesh, right? So his hold on us is released.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
God.
Thank you, Lord.
Good word. Anyone else? No? Okay, let's stand. And let's come to the Lord this morning. Father, we thank you for bringing us together here to be gathering your name. We thank you, Lord, for giving us the word to share with our brothers and sisters, and also to go out into this world and share them.
Thank you.
one point in time, as Suzanne was saying, it seemed like this church building was lifted up into the atmosphere that the Lord had brought forth. So he stirred it up. He stirred it up. He stirred it up. He put his ear. Let him hear. Thank you.
Thank you.
during this election time. Tell my people not to hide in foxholes until this is over. Don't just stick your head in the sand and wait for this thing to pass. Be a voice. Be a voice. Be a voice. You're not electing what people may call a high priest. You're not electing a person who is going to be quote unquote a pope. You're going after a man who will, or a person, or a woman, or someone who will start steering this ship, this nation, back into the right direction. Who you vote for is between you and the Lord. But all I can say, brothers and sisters, this is not the time to stick around the sand and wait for this storm to pass. This nation is shredded. This nation is divided. And that's exactly where the enemy wants it. The Lord says, rise up, church. Rise up, body of Christ. When that flag was being anointed Friday night, Suzanne was directed to do all four corners of that flag, representing all four corners of this country. And the position our flag is right here is frayed on the end. It's frayed on the end, and I understand that. I wish it wasn't, but it is. This country is frayed in so many ways right now. If the Lord can work through Nebuchadnezzar, he can work through his elect. If he can work through Nebuchadnezzar of the Babylonians, he can work through whoever's elected. But people don't hide in your foxholes. Watch him diligently, because he is king. He is king. Thank you.
bless you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for all of your goodness and your mercy that you've shown us. Lord, we thank you for being you, for saving us, preserving us, and then releasing us, Lord, as your offspring to bear your image to a fallen world seeking identity that you alone can provide. For that, we bless you this morning, Lord, and for eternity, we will be thankful. In Jesus' name, praise the Lord. Give him a hand this morning. God bless you. Be seated, please. Thanks again, Mike. Thanks, Roberto, for opening. Thank you all for your testimonies and prayer requests and sharing what God's put on your heart. Praise the Lord. Good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. You know, the Bible talks about discerning between good and evil and having the mind of Christ to be able to determine, differentiate between things. You know, I lived in South Carolina for a while, and then Sally and I also lived in southeast Texas, about as far east as you can get in Texas and not be in Louisiana. And so we saw a few bayous and swamps. You ever wonder how you can tell the difference between alligators and crocodiles? You ever think about it? I mean, it's not difficult because one you see later and the other after a while. Keep that in mind the next time you're dealing with reptiles. It'll help you. Praise the Lord. Yeah, it's really not that hard. Praise the Lord. All right, let's get into the Word of God this morning. Romans chapter 10, and I want to read verses 2 and 3. Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 10 and verses 2 and 3. For I bear them record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Now, I'm going to read you the New Living Translation that reads like this. I know what enthusiasm they have for God, but it's misdirected zeal, for they don't understand God's way of making people right with himself. Refusing to accept God's way, they cling to their own way of getting right with God by trying to keep the law. So, here's the thing about grace. It's always sufficient. It's always enough for whatever we need. The concept of grace is difficult to understand because it's an attribute of an infinite God. It's not something that comes natural to human beings outside of the born-again experience. And so it doesn't seem logical in rational thinking. Amen? So let's look at Romans chapter 16, verses 24 through 27. Paul starts off, he says, grace to you. You know, that's a common theme, obviously, throughout the New Testament, but especially in Paul's writings. There's not a book that he wrote that doesn't speak directly to grace, but then also he'll just say grace to you either at the end or the beginning, however it is the context in which he's speaking. But he says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel. And we know it's the gospel of grace. That's the only means by which you can be established in the power of God. It's the power of God in you. Amen. And the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began. Now is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. To God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. So in our finite minds, our limited knowledge, I said before, you know, Einstein said that the difference between genius and stupidity is that genius has its limits. Praise the Lord. So sometimes we have a finite mind, limited, I mean, in comparison to God. So they just can't, our natural mind just can't comprehend the fullness of who God is.
Amen.
Amen? And the grace that comes from God is one of the biggest mysteries in the scriptures. It goes further than our taboos, than our, you know, personal no-nos and dislikes about other people's behavior. And it takes us places that our hang-ups just can't go. That's why religion limits, because it points the finger at us and we see our frailness and our faults and our weaknesses and our sins. Amen. And we never get past that, just like what Don was talking about. So this is about Christ. And to Eric's point, which is right on as well, there's only one way we can manifest God, and that's by being in Christ.
Yes.
The human can't do it. No matter how religious we are, it never points people to Jesus. It points them to our denomination or our particular group or belief system or what have you. And Judas is a perfect example. Some people choose the wrong thing, even when they're offered the purest form of grace, which is Jesus himself. You cannot have Christ and not have grace. Amen? That's the beauty of grace. God extends it to us knowing that we might not choose it.
Sure.
Praise the Lord. Even though he knows the end from the beginning,
yes,
and even though he knows we have a free will that he gave us,
he
still extends mercy and grace. Amen? He still gives us the option. Grace is so completely undeserved, it's not even based on God's all-knowing omniscience. Amen? What I just said. Even though he knows we may refuse it, he still offers it. He still gives it. He still makes it available. Amen? Let's look at Matthew chapter 10, verses 7 and 8. And I'll show you, try to bring out something here, where Jesus sent his disciples out to go preach. Now, they didn't have the Holy Spirit, but they were anointed with the Holy Spirit at that moment to go do what they were. Obviously, he hadn't died, been buried, or resurrected, but still, he gave them an anointing. The anointing was grace. Amen? And we talk about wanting to operate in the Spirit by the anointing. There's only one way to really do it. It's by grace. You're never going to get good enough. You're never going to get powerful enough in yourself. You're never going to get, you know, spiritual enough or whatever it is in yourself. It's in Christ. It's faith in him that's going to make the difference. And so he says, as you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you have received. Freely give. To receive the gift of grace, we need the anointing. That's why except the Spirit draws and nobody comes.
Exactly.
So you have to be operating by the Spirit, the ability of the Spirit. That's the beauty of grace. It allows us to operate in the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, even in our humanity. Praise the Lord. So Jesus commissioned his disciples to operate in the supernatural, to freely receive the anointing and freely give it to others. And the anointing, you know, there isn't, you know, it's like if you had, you know, a room full of people, believers, and they're believing for whatever their need is. You can have one person here with a physical problem, another one with an emotional issue, another with a financial problem, another with some other thing. Everybody can receive from one anointing. Because the anointing is Christ. It's the grace of God, amen, and everybody can receive whatever it is they need. That's why, you know, I'm fine with healing services, but why? Just have the service and believe God, and there'll be healings. There'll be deliverance. There'll be people set free. There'll be all of these things because that's what the anointing does. Freely you receive, freely you give it. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, hallelujah. To have it, you have to have it as a gift. It has to come freely. It has to be released freely. Romans chapter 10 again. Let's go back to where we started, verses 2 and 3. He said, I know you have a zeal for God. I bear you record a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. So you got a lot of excitement, a lot of work ethic, a lot of other things, but not a lot of intellect here, not a lot of understanding, right? They, being ignorant of God's righteousness, are going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. So, I mean, I want to just present this to you. If healings take place, they don't take place because of my ministry. They don't take place because of your ministry. They take place because you believe in the goodness of God. You believe in the grace of God. You believe in the reality of a God who does heal, who has healed, who has set people free. Praise the Lord. Amen. So grace especially offends the religious person because it doesn't make sense to them. Religion based on law. And as a result, my works, because I'm the one that has to fulfill the law, right? Grace is based on Jesus' act of freely giving himself for our sins, the sins of the world. Amen? And every step from that point forward operates the same way. If you get saved by grace, that's the message to Galatians. If that's how you came into this thing, why do you now want to make it about you? God's way is Jesus. The religious way, the human way, is works. God's way is a gift. Human way is a heavy yoke that'll wear you out, that'll bum you out, and everybody else that's around you. It breeds a religious spirit. So Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. He, Jesus, being the author and finisher of our faith, right? Without him, we don't have it. It was his faith that accomplished everything that's been accomplished. Our faith is simply in him, in his finished work. So, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Praise the Lord. Grace gets its strength by being captivated or focused on Jesus. Faith in faith won't do a thing. It's faith in Jesus that makes everything happen. It's to draw our attention to him, to make our focus about him. Amen? Faith. And that scripture, that word there where it's used, faith, it's translated over and over in the Bible as gospel truth. We make faith a, you know, a major, major, just struggle. The truth is, faith is simply believing in the truth of the gospel.
Yes, that's it.
It's not, you don't have to conjure it up. You don't have to work it up. You don't have, just believe in what he's done. And God calls that faith. Amen. He declares it to be faith. Praise the Lord. All right, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. By grace are you saved. Through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast, right? For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Praise the Lord. True grace brings glory to God and not to us, not to people. You know, and the thing is, most Christians, they don't have a problem with being saved by grace, but they got a big problem with anything else by grace. Goes clear back to the first century. Goes clear back to the Galatians. Probably before. But Paul addresses the same problem that all of us have to deal with on a continuing basis. Amen? We were saved by grace. So just let grace be the thing that leads you into every other approach to God. Every other breakthrough in God. Every other revelation in God. You know, none of us, I mean, most of us here come from all kinds of different backgrounds, religious and non-religious, different church organizations and so on and so forth. It wasn't because we fought so hard to get to this place. It's by grace. We receive what it is that God gives us, whatever revelation that might be, and are open to whatever God wants to do, and that's how we get to where we are. It's by grace, not by us just hunkering down somewhere back in time and saying, man, somehow I'm going to get to the bottom of all of this. Because I don't know that there's a bottom to it.
Right.
You know, the height, the depth, the length, the width, it's not ending. It's never ending. So at some point we have to realize wherever we are, whatever we are, like Paul said, it's because of grace. Amen? See, Jesus never demanded purgatory. Now, this isn't an attack on the Catholic Church. I'm just saying. We live most of our lives in purgatory.
Yeah.
Somewhere between saved and lost.
Yeah.
Always struggling, always trying to do more. If you know anything about purgatory, that's what's going on. Their prayers are going up continuously, continuously trying to get those people from somewhere between hell and heaven to move them on. Well, Jesus never speaks of purgatory. This life is not supposed to be purgatory. There's not something between this life and eternity that's called purgatory. Look at Luke chapter 23, verses 42 and 43. It's the thief on the cross next to Jesus, and he said, Master, or Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom, right? And Jesus said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, this day you will be with me in paradise. No purgatory. No expiating, you know, of sins or correcting your wrongs or your faults or anything else. It's just simply, here you are, there you are. Separated from God, one with God. Amen? No purgatory. Just paradise now. Praise the Lord. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 16 through 19. There's a couple of things in this two or three verses here that I want you to notice. He says, he talks about faith from the heart. And then he talks about comprehending. So Paul's prayer is that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints, comprehend now, with all saints, what's the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. On the one hand, he's telling us you need to understand this emotionally, you need to understand this from the heart, but there's also an intellectual thing going on here. Amen? Understanding God. Now, I hope I can make some kind of sense, because I'm not picking on either side of this thing, intellectual or emotional. I'm just saying it takes both. That's why God created us the way he did. But understanding God in love is important for people who live in their head and for people who live in their heart. Because we all function a little bit differently. Some people, you know, they talk about they wear their feelings on their sleeve, you know. Other people, you wouldn't know what their feelings are if you could cut their head open and pick their brain, right? I mean, some people are more reserved, more internal. Other people, they go about, you know, every time they have a feeling, you know it. I mean, I'm talking about the extremes now, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So it's important that we understand God in love, that we understand God through the eyes of love, through the understanding of love. And it's important for people that live in their feelings, and it's important for people who live in their intellect. Both need to learn to ground their identity in the experience of knowing themselves as deeply loved by God. Spoken here this morning already about self-condemnation. The only way to overcome that is to understand that God completely loves you just like you are. That doesn't mean we don't want to be better people or we don't want to continue, you know, doing things that are dysfunctional or destructive. It just means that even when we do, God still loves us. It doesn't change his mind about us. Amen? So we need to learn to ground our identity in this experience of knowing ourselves the way God knows us. You ever think about what God thinks about when he thinks of you? I know that's kind of convoluted, but you know what I'm saying? I mean, maybe that thought never comes to anybody else, but sometimes I wonder, you know, how you think of somebody you care for and the thoughts that come to you about them, you know? So why wouldn't God do the same thing when he thinks about us? Problem is, most of us think when he thinks about us, he goes, oh my God, I don't want to think about that. When in fact, he loves to dwell on us, to dote on us, to think about us, to like a couple that are in love. You know, you're not together, you're still thinking about them. You're wondering how they're doing, is everything okay, and blah, 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 blah. And you reminisce, amen, about the times when you're together, right? So both sides of this thing need to understand God through the identity of his love for us. Deeply loved by God. Now, here's what I want to show you. If you can bring it back up there, Sheila, verses 17 and 18 at least, of Ephesians 3. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love, right, may be able to comprehend with all saints the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height. Amen. So we need this from the heart. We need to understand it in the heart. We need to understand it in the head. And tending to not know or trust feelings, people who live predominantly in their thoughts and rational kind of analysis and working things out logically, you know, they need to learn to embrace their feelings. It makes you more human and more alive. Now, I'm not a person who's very emotional. I tend to stay more inside myself. Well, I mean, I do goofy things, obviously, but it's more about just being goofy than it is anything else. But I'm not one to share all of my feelings. And my wife would be the first one to tell you that. It's just the way I am. That's the way I was raised, I guess. That's just kind of my thing. You know, that's the way I am. I'm not particularly proud of it or ashamed of it. It's just, you know, it's just me. That doesn't mean I disrespect people who are more emotional. I have trouble relating sometimes to a lot of emotion, but I mean, I get it. I understand where they're coming from. But my point is, tending to not know or trust feelings, the people who live predominantly in thoughts and rational way of thinking need to learn to embrace their feelings. And I think that's why when I first got saved, I was a mess. I mean, I was a mess before I got saved, and I was still a mess after I got saved. I'd go to church, and I'd just start crying. It was the most humiliating, embarrassing thing that you can imagine for me personally. Now, other people were doing it, and they were quite pleased with the whole thing. But for me, it was humiliating. But I couldn't control it. I mean, I couldn't over... It wasn't like I'm thinking some sad thought. I'm just sitting there in a church service and worshiping, and the next thing you know, I'm not just tears. There was a couple of times I had to get up and leave the room. It's a large church, you know. And I have to just, you know, like a 10-year-old girl, you know, just crying. It was horrible. But God was putting me in touch with feelings that I hadn't, that I didn't even know existed, you know what I'm saying? And that was overwhelming for me. But that's the point I'm trying to make. God makes, those kind of feelings make you more human. Praise the Lord. Feelings bring new data. I found it out. I wasn't crazy about it, but it brings information that I really wasn't in tune with. You know what I'm saying? And so that's what I'm talking about. Feelings bring information. They bring data that's missing when only thoughts and intellect are trusted. And people who live mainly by feelings, by their emotions, need to learn to move beyond the superficial feelings that create their experiences into deeper, more genuine emotional encounters. And I'm telling you, I don't know how many of y'all have been around Pentecostals and all of this charismatic, but I'm telling you, a lot of it, I get it, but sometimes I think, wow, good for the feeling, but how about making some kind of sense of it? Praise the Lord. So they need to move beyond the superficial feelings into a more genuine emotional encounter. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm talking about these kind of people. They don't need fewer emotions. That's not my point. They need deeper, more authentic ones. Right. So you're not moved by every flight of fancy or every little thing that happens that freak you out or turn you into a nut, right? You need to embrace some critical thinking in order to judge those feelings. Because I spent about 2 years doing that. Because I was having feelings that I'd never really had before. And at some point I had to say, I can't just go by these feelings. I got to figure out where these feelings are coming from and why. So you start doing a little critical analysis. I'm not mad about the feelings. I don't want to get rid of the feelings because they were a great experience. They helped me to feel more in tune with God. But I want to be able to make some sense out of them too. I don't want to just, you know, it's like we talk about, you know, getting goosebumps and things. Hey, look, I get the goosebumps every time I hear the Marine Corps hymn. I get goosebumps when I see a parade and the flag. But that don't make it the Holy Ghost. That doesn't make it God trying to move on me. It's an emotional response to something, amen, that I have a connection with somehow. So that's what I'm saying. I don't want to just feel stuff. I want to be able to feel. He's touched by the feelings of our infirmities. He has feelings. Obviously, he was a human being, so he knows what it is. But I don't want to just be moved by feelings. I want those feelings to have some substance or some root that I can relate to, that I can understand, or that I can express to somebody else.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So we need to have a way of thinking critically in order to judge feelings, so that we're not just operating by feelings alone, but we're operating by the mind of Christ.
Yeah.
Our minds in tune with our emotions. Praise the Lord. See, knowing God in love, it gives us the opportunity. This is, I'm not trying to give you a psychological evaluation here or anything. I'm just saying this is what I see in the Scripture. What God's trying to get us to do is to be balanced. He's trying to get us to understand that he's giving us an opportunity to move beyond sentimentalism,
right,
and emotionalism,
right,
to a place where we're really being led by the Spirit of God. Whether I'm feeling it or not feeling it.
Exactly.
Whether I got the, you know, the all the I's dotted and the T's crossed. Amen. He's trying to get us to be grounded in our identity in the love of God. That we are loved by God. If that doesn't happen, we end up fearing and longing for the thing that we need the most.
Right. Yes.
And we end up with religion instead of a relationship.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. All right, let's look at Mark chapter 2, verses 15 and 17. This is similar to what Roberto was referring to in the story of the prodigal son. They all kind of start out this way. And it is that Jesus, when the scribes and Pharisees saw him eat with publicans and sinners, they said unto his disciples, how is it that he eateth and drinketh with publicans and sinners? When Jesus heard it, he saith unto them, they that are whole have no need of a physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Amen. So, in other words, to change their mind about God, to change their mind about who God is, how God responds to them, how God relates to them. Amen? So I just want to say this morning. Think about this relative to revival. So when you think about revival, think about grace. We've had all kinds of things that we've called revival, and I'm not the one who defines revival, but I would just say in the church that we were in Texas, a large church, an influential church there in Southeast Texas, we had several revivals a year.
Yeah.
Or at least that's what we called them.
Yeah.
Because we had a special speaker come in and do certain things, and we called that revival.
Right.
It wasn't revival, it was special services. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm not against having special services. I'm just saying if it's a special service, just call it a special service, and we'll let God determine what's a revival.
Yeah.
Because we're calling all kinds of stuff revival that isn't revival.
That's the truth.
It's something else. Praise the Lord. I'm not against revival or people wanting revival or struggling to, you know, produce it. But it ain't going to happen that way.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Revival doesn't look like a good church service.
No.
I have seen real revival. Mm-hmm. That doesn't make me special. It just makes me a, you know, product of my geographic location. Praise the Lord. I just happen to be in the right place at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not like any normal kind of church service. In fact, most religious people would be put off by it. Because it's not very neat.
Right.
It's messy and it's kind of awkward. And we've had a few experiences like that where where God has sent certain people here. I remember, I won't say his name. Some of you may remember him, but he came. He was a guy living off the street. In fact, he lived up here underneath the bridge, and then he camped out in the woods down here by the river for a while. And he come by one day looking for cans. And I didn't have cans, but I gave him a few bucks, and then he kept coming back around, and I assumed it was for a few more bucks, you know. And it was, but it was still a God connection. And so I invited him to come, you know, to church. And, of course, he'd come, and he'd just be loaded, you know. I mean, drunk. And I'm not talking about having a few beers or something, but you could just, the smell was so strong on him that it would just make you a little dizzy. And he'd come in, and he'd kind of get caught up in the service, and then he'd want to testify, and he'd start cussing. Anybody remember Dave? David was his name, because I remember now he's same name as my older brother. And he's trying to praise the Lord, but, I mean, he doesn't understand all the, you know, the right verbiage here. So he's just saying, by God, I love the Lord, you know. And then beyond that, I mean, I won't repeat, not in front of you at least, some of the stuff that he said. I mean, but he had good intentions. He was trying to reach out to God the only way he knew how. My feeling was, God's crazy about this, but nobody else is. You know, I mean, he smells bad, not just the alcohol, but I mean, he's living under a bridge, so, you know. Right. And we've had several things very similar to that. I helped get him an intermediary basically between him and Social Security, so he could get Social Security, and he now lives in a hotel or motel down on the east side of Des Moines. So it's good. I mean, to that extent, we were able to help him a little bit. But more importantly, we were able to introduce him to a God who isn't judging him based on his income, his address, his habits, his whatever. And that's what I'm most proud of, if I could say pride, in what we've done here. Those kind of things that people who otherwise have always felt on the outside, always felt like the impossible for them. I can tell you a story. I was divorced, living in Greencastle, Pennsylvania, back in the 70s, early 70s. And I had two kids living with me. And I worked for a hotel as a bartender on weekends. During the week, I steamed crabs, the kind you eat. Praise the Lord. I got fired from the hotel because I wrecked the boss's Buick drinking. This is I'm not trying for sympathy. I'm just saying I was stupid. I was a very foolish person. So I still had two kids I had to support. So I rented an apartment, and I have all these row apartments. They're sitting right on the sidewalk from these. None of them spoke English. So I never knew for sure what my rent was or when. They just come and show up with their hand out, and I'd give them what I had. But my point is this: when you feel the draw of God, generally, sadly, it's not because of His goodness. It is His goodness that we respond to, but most of the time, it's our mess that draws us to God. So I got these two kids, school age, 5 and 6. And so I figure I got to do something. I got to be responsible. I can't just live this, you know, kind of bachelor part life, you know. So I go to this church. I won't tell you what the brand was, but it was just down the street from where I lived. And I took the kids. We were clean. We were well-dressed. It wasn't like we were smelly and nasty and everything else. I take them to church, and, you know, not one person spoke to us. And I felt embarrassed for my children. For me, I could care less. But I wasn't looking for a friend at the time. I was looking for some place to get my kids into an environment that was more positive than what they had been in with just me. But to this day, I'm still angry about it. Because they rejected my kids. It wasn't me. I've been rejected before, you know. But here, where I'm trying to introduce them to the Lord, where I'm trying to introduce them to the reality of God that I knew existed, I just didn't really want to be a part of it right at that time. And the people that were to represent him didn't have the time of day for two kids that were just there because their dad brought them, you know what I mean? I don't know about anybody else, but man, we need to show the love of God to people somehow, some way. When they come and visit, I don't care how you do it, but listen, people are looking for that. They're not necessarily looking for a buddy. Maybe that'll develop, but what they're looking for is the love of God. And if we, as the representatives of God, can't reach out to somebody and at least take a moment to say, hi, glad you're here, we appreciate you coming, let them know that it means something. Because it means everything to God. So much to God that he gave his life for this. Praise the Lord. So that's one of those little things I get off on. I don't know why, except that I just haven't gotten over it. Pray for me that I find forgiveness for that particular denomination. Hallelujah. But I'm saying revival doesn't look like good church service. Now, revival looks like a whore on crack getting somehow saved and delivered. Then when she comes to church and she prays for somebody in a wheelchair and they get healed, you don't get offended that God didn't pick you to do the miracle. Instead, you celebrate God's goodness and God's grace for everybody. And if we're to have revival on any level, that's what we ought to expect. I took an extreme here because, look, when I was born again, when I got saved, I'd been on drugs for years, I'd been on alcohol. I was a functioning alcoholic and a functioning drug addict. I had good jobs, and I worked full-time, and I worked hard. But I was high all the time, and I was drunk all the time. Just so happened that my job was in sales, which kind of lent itself, you know, to spend a lot of time in bars and you know, drinking with potential customers.
Sure.
I got more names on the dotted line after, you know, half a bottle of Jack Daniels than I did with all of the best sales pitching I could do, praise the Lord. I'm not justifying it. I'm not encouraging it. I'm just saying that is the fact. That's the way it was. So I'm saying that, you know, we have to understand God, when I came to the Lord, that was my baggage. And that because I felt bad about it and knew that it was not respectable and right, I figured everybody else felt the same way. And I'll tell you, the church we went to, it was a freak show. I mean, it was a huge Jesus name, Holy Ghost, one God, I mean, holiness church, Pentecostal, and I mean, no cutting hair, and men no facial hair, and, you know, long sleeve shirts, and the women with dresses all the time, and long hair, and the hair up, and all this kind of stuff. And that was one thing, which was kind of a shock, because I had a beard and everything else when we went, and I'm looking around. It took me a little while to realize I was the only one like that. Everybody else looked like Mr. Clean. And all the women's hair and all the other stuff. And then the service starts. We had taken our daughter to the nursery, which was clear around, like the sanctuary was in the middle, and then there was a all the way around, there were Sunday school classes and office space and so on and so forth. It was a large building, large church. So we took our daughter to the nursery. At the time, she was only about two or three years old or whatever. And then we come back into the sanctuary, and we're seated, and all of a sudden, it starts. The shouting, the jumping, the running, the whole works, you know. And I looked at Sally and I thought, oh my God, and they've got our daughter. Honestly, that's what I thought. These people have our child. Her mother came to visit us after we were saved. Her mother came to visit us once, and she was from the same denomination we had grown up in as kids, disciples of Christ. And she was a great lady, a God-fearing woman, really a good person, but I'm telling you, it freaked her from two ways to Sunday. I mean, she's sitting there, and I remember her saying to Sally, she said, God, what are they going to do next? And Sally said, just wait a minute. I mean, you know, anybody's been in Pentecostal service, you know, it gets pretty wild. And for somebody who isn't a part of that, who hasn't experienced it before, it can be frightening, it can be intimidating, you know. But it got to where, you know, man, I scream louder, run faster, and leap higher and do everything, that, you know, just like everybody else, because it's all acceptable. When and we have revival. Can you imagine if that was a normal service? What happened in revivals? So, you know, I get, you know, I'm just rambling here for some reason, but I remember having certain, some preachers would come and they'd I'm evaluating the whole thing all the time. Now I'm good with God. I mean, I believe in God, but the rest of the stuff I'm still measuring. You know, I'm still trying to figure out, okay, what is and what isn't. And so we're trying to, you know, the preachers would get up there, or the worship leader, whoever it would be, and they'd say, okay, now I remember, especially evangelists, and they'd say, okay, now if people aren't shouting enough, and they're not jumping high enough, and they're not really carrying on emotionally, then it wasn't a great service. So they'd have you get up and have what they called victory marches. I hated that. I mean, if you want me out of the Spirit, tell me to get in the Spirit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? If you want to see somebody carnal, try to force me into the Spirit and see what happens. I mean, I'm like a mule. I just dig in right then. I'm thinking, okay, something's not right about this. If they got to tell me to get up and march around here until I get into the Spirit, we could be here for months. Yeah. If I'm not trusting God to get me into the Spirit, or to, you know, to move with the presence of God, then the rest of this is all... And then that causes you to feel like, wait a minute, who's in charge here? I mean, is God running the show, or is, you know, are we? So that's why I don't do it. I'm not saying it's wrong to say, come on, praise the Lord. I'm saying, come on and praise the Lord. You praise the Lord. I mean, you don't need me to tell you to praise the Lord. That seems not right to me. You understand what I'm saying? It's like, like me. Come on, like me. I said like me. I got a feeling people are going to be going, whoa, wait a minute. I don't think I like him. Thought might not even occur to you until I tell you, you got to like me. So we need to just be us and let the Holy Spirit lead us and guide us. If you feel like shouting, you shout on, brother. I mean, go for it. If you feel like weeping, weep. Yes. Weep, cry, go ahead. There's nothing wrong with it. If you want to get up and run out the door and around the building and come on back, that's good with me. I'm fine with it. Just don't sit there waiting for me to try to get you to do it.
Exactly.
Because it's just not going to happen. Yep. We're either led by the Spirit, or we're led by our religious kind of obligations and sense of peer pressure that I'm not interested in. Praise the Lord. So, you celebrate the goodness of God, the great God, and what God does. And that's real revival. That is a revival of grace. And that's what we want, isn't it?
Yes.
We want to be led by the Spirit, and we want people to come to believe they can be led by the Spirit, that they don't need me giving them a list of how to be led by the Spirit. They just need to have enough confidence in the love of God and the goodness of God that they can know that God will direct my steps, even when I'm not in total sync with Him. If God was blessing me in so many ways back then, and I didn't know anything. I assumed that everything that happened there was real because I got saved. I knew I was saved. I knew I'd had a life-changing thing happen. So initially I thought, well, it must all be right then, because why would God save me in some place that was dysfunctional? And it had a lot of positive things going on there, a lot of good Bible teaching and a lot of, you know, good things taking place there. But a lot of it was just the opposite. I had a young man, what was his name? The goat roper, remember? Myron? Not Myron. Malcolm. Malcolm, that was it. I'll just give you a couple examples. Here's two people don't know anything about God, nothing at all. This kid is a East Texas rodeo guy. He knows nothing but cows and horses. And this girl was totally dysfunctional, and they fall in love, or at least he did, with her. I was teaching her a Bible study at the time, Sally and I were. She had been so traumatized as a child. She was sitting in her mother's lap at, I think, 4 years old. And her father came in and blew her brains out right on top of her. White, she's sitting in her mother's lap, and a guy comes in and poof, shoots her dead while she's holding this little girl. Obviously, the father goes to prison forever, and the mother goes to the grave. And the little girl grows up with all of this, not being able to figure any of it out. Very insecure, all kinds of stuff. But Malcolm's in love with her, wants to marry her. And I thought, this probably ain't going to be good, because Malcolm's not the kind of emotionally comforting person that she probably needs. And so anyway, he wanted to get saved. So he come to a service. We were having a revival. And in those days, this is how you got saved. You repent, and you get baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of your sins. It's biblical. It's all there in Acts 2. And you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, that's very kind of regimented, and it happens all kinds of ways, but that's the way it's always defined. So I'm praying with the kid, and he's not a kid. I mean, he's like in his early 20s. And he's down at the altar. He's shaking, you know. He's everything. I said, man, come on, just let go. Just go ahead. Speak in tongues. You're the one that's going to do it. You know, this is for you. It's a gift, you know. It doesn't happen. So service ends. We're still down there at the altar going through all of that. And he says, well, can I get baptized? And I said, of course. So we take him up to the baptistry, baptize him. He comes up out of the water, speaking in tongues. Just, I mean, like he'd been talking in tongues all of his life. Of course, that was our identifier. And it's not unbiblical. It's just that when you start looking for that to be the thing that does it, then it gets a little confusing. But nevertheless, I said, man, why didn't you do that down there? And I wouldn't have had to ruin a perfectly good suit. Sweat through everything, you know? And he said, well, you said that you had to be baptized in order to receive the Holy Spirit. See, he was taking everything so literally that when we said repent, be baptized, receive the Holy Spirit, that was it. He wasn't going to receive the Holy Spirit evidenced by speaking in other tongues unless he was baptized, because that's what we told him it had to be. So you don't understand how much influence we have on people and how distorted we can create things in their lives that just conflict, that just keep them from God instead of just causing them to surrender and relax. Well, he should have just said, man, God loves you so much. You got it. All you got to do is receive it. All you got to do is accept it. I'm saying this just because people come here, and I don't know if they're waiting for the vast majority of people that are here are people that are already saved, right? But God is going to bring people that are not saved. Now, what are we going to give them? Doctrine or Jesus? Yeah. My belief is, give them Jesus and they'll be able to receive anything that the scripture says. Amen. If they get Jesus, they'll be able to discern between what's God and what's not God. Exactly. What God wants and what some denomination wants. Exactly. Our job is to love them. Amen. To Jesus.
Amen.
And then let Jesus do the rest. If they come and want advice, they come and want it, then be there for them.
Sure.
Praise the Lord. All right, let's go to Hosea chapter 1. I'm just going to read two verses here. While we were sitting here earlier, I looked at a couple of scriptures, and it was kind of interesting, because in Jeremiah, and this is throughout the Bible, but I'm just randomly looking at a couple of scriptures. In Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 1, God talks about a husband and a wife where the wife is unfaithful. And he says, don't have nothing to do with her again. Don't take her back. You're done. Once it happens, it's over. In Deuteronomy 24:4, it says the same thing. It's God saying, that is wrong. It's sin. Don't do it. Right? So here's God now in Hosea chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. I'm sorry, Sheila, I didn't mean for you to have to go there, but Yeah, you can go look them up. It's there. Deuteronomy 24:4 and Jeremiah 3, verse 1. But it's everywhere else. You can find it anywhere. But here's God speaking to Hosea. And he says, beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea, and the Lord said to Hosea, go take unto thee a wife of whoredoms. Now, what's wrong with this picture? I mean, you've got at least two places that I've already told you where God said, don't ever do this.
Yeah.
Right? And here, you know, he says it because if you go on to see, read the rest of the story, so to speak, he says, here's the reason why. Because you're going to end up with illegitimate children. Now, he's talking, this is all a metaphor for Israel and God's people.
Right.
And I don't want mixture, right? So you got to stay faithful, or otherwise we don't know where the seed's coming from. That's the purpose behind it, because he goes on to talk about that. But here he's talking to Hosea, and he says, beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea, go take thee a wife of whoredoms and children of whoredoms. In other words, bastard children, illegitimate children, which is what he's against, totally against, in Deuteronomy and Jeremiah. So, wife of whoredoms and children of whoredoms, for the land hath committed great whoredom, departing from the Lord. So he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim, which conceived and bare him a son. Now, after this, she goes back to prostituting,
right,
and has other children,
right,
not Hosea's, by whoredoms, by prostitution. She ends up with other children. Hosea, if you read it, oddly enough, he falls in love with the woman. And he takes her back. God tells him to take her back. And he takes her back with these illegitimate children and makes them his. That's the picture of this thing.
Right.
So God has Israel, right? Yeah, those are his children, right?
Yeah.
Jesus comes and he goes to the house of his father,
right,
to his children, and they reject him. So he tells his disciples, now you can go to the illegitimate,
mm-hmm,
and bring them in. So Paul's doing this, all of his gospels, everything he's doing, that's what he's doing. He's out picking up the illegitimate children and bringing them back to the Father,
yes,
who says now they're mine.
Yes.
I don't care where they came from. I don't care who their father was.
Right.
Adam, I'm their father. I'm going to take them and be their father.
Yes.
And I'm going to love them just like they were my own.
Amen.
Because now they are. They're born
in,
right? So she goes back to prostituting. God tells Hosea, bring her back. Take her illegitimate children as your own.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let me ask you a question. If Hosea was your brother or your best friend,
mm-hmm,
what would your advice be to Hosea when he says, I'm going to get Gomer and bring her back and all four of her illegitimate children?
Yep.
Sadly, we know what most of us would say. Are you nuts?
Yeah.
That woman is a mess.
Yes.
She's going to ruin those kids. She's going to ruin you. She's going to ruin everything. Can you not see past your love for her that she is despicable? She's disgusting. She's humiliating. She's an embarrassment to you. The ugly picture here is the picture of God's grace.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
His extreme goodness to the undeserving.
Yes. Absolutely.
To those without a right or rights.
Amen.
Praise God. That's revival. With all of its mess, with its embarrassments, with its humiliations, with its sometimes you got to hold your nose to hug. But that's revival.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Romans chapter 11, verse 29 through 31. See, the calling and election elections of God are without repentance. The beginning of the word, for the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. For as ye in times past have not believed God, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief. Even so have these also now not believed, that through your mercy they also may obtain mercy.
Yes.
That's Christianity.
Yes, it is.
In three verses.
Yes, it is.
We were the bastards.
Yes.
We were the illegitimate. And mercy was shown us.
Yeah.
Now, come on.
Yeah.
Be merciful.
Amen.
Give that same mercy.
Yes.
To somebody else that was just like you.
Yes.
That's revival.
Yes, it is.
That is true Christianity. Because God's calling and election on you doesn't change. He doesn't change his mind about it.
No.
He doesn't go, whoops, I guess that was a bad choice. No, once
no.
He chose you, he called you, he gifts you the anointing.
Yes, he does.
Jesus. Use it. Freely you received. Freely give.
Amen.
Is it so simple? We've made... Because it's religion, we've made it so complicated. It isn't complicated. God loves you beyond any way that we can comprehend love. And he's asking us then just use the love that you've got and love somebody else.
Amen.
And watch it grow. Because the love that you share with somebody else increases the love that flows from God. You'll understand God better. You'll understand your relationship with God better. You'll be more empowered than you can imagine by just simply giving it to somebody else.
Yes.
Praying for them.
Amen.
Believing them.
Amen.
Helping them. Doing whatever the requirement is.
Yep.
See, the whole point is God is not interested in punishing us. He's not interested in punishing anybody. Romans 2, verse 4. You say, well, I don't know. I haven't ever really operated any spiritual gifts. Well, operate in something you can operate in and see what happens as a result of it. Despisest thou the riches of goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. Another translation is kindness. Grace of God is also kindness. Grace in the form of Jesus, kindness that saves us. Say, well, I've laid hand on the sick, but I haven't seen anybody healed yet. Well, keep laying hands on them and keep praying for them. It'll happen. But in the meantime, you can just be kind.
Sure.
Right? In the meantime, you can do this.
Yes.
And see what God will do as a result of it. Some of us want to go around. I mean, that's where part of the problem with religious people go around all grumpy and angry and frustrated and bitter, and then they say, oh, just come as you are. You know, God loves you. We despise you because, you know, you're not like us yet, but that's okay. God likes you.
Yeah.
Be kind and see if the opportunities don't come for somebody then to say, would you pray for me because I got this thing. Right? I got this situation. I got this circumstance. I got this sickness. I got this whatever. Because now I trust you because you're kind. Because you're just a good person. I can trust you that you're not out to manipulate me and take advantage of me and humiliate me.
Right.
And the next thing you know, God's healing. And God's delivering. And God's setting free. Why? Because they've repented. They've changed their mind about God because of you. All of a sudden, now God's not this ogre that's out to punish everybody and hurt everybody. Maybe God's pretty good. Maybe God's kind, like this person who believes they have a relationship with him.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? It's not complicated. You don't need a 3-year course, you know, in theology to do these things.
Exactly.
Praise God. The love of God is intense. And his grace seems unfair. But his desire is that none perish.
That's right.
Colossians 2, verses 8 through 10. Sheila, this will be the last scripture. Colossians 2, 8 through 10. See, there's too much vain philosophy. Now, I know there's different ways of interpreting that, but I'll just give it this interpretation, vanity, about the individual's philosophy. It's vain philosophy, not simply because it has no value, but because the person is so vain. It's a Carly Simon record. Yeah. You're so vain, I bet you think this is about you.
Yeah.
Well, we're so vain, we think it's about us.
Yeah, we do.
And it's not about us, it's about Jesus. But we're so vain. We have this philosophy that we call religion that makes it all about us. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Without understanding our identity in the love of God, we'll never be who we're supposed to be. We'll never rise to the fullness of the stature of Jesus Christ that he says the church has to come to. That's why I believe we're in the times that we're in. I believe that's why we're seeing a lot of the things that we're seeing. I believe that's why we're identifying with grace and being in Christ, because it can't happen any other way.
Right.
Religion's had its run. I'm not saying religion's going away. I'm just saying it's not going to do anything that it hasn't been doing for 2,000 years, which is just kind of marking time till God gives a revelation of his true purpose, which is that we understand his love, live in that love, and share it with everybody.
Exactly.
So, you go back to the early church, that's all they were doing.
Yeah.
It wasn't like they had this real complicated, complex theological, you know, developing program. They just went out and loved the way they'd been loved. They gave away what had freely been given to them.
Yes. That's it.
And God added to the church thousands upon thousands, to the point that the whole world was turned upside down as a result of his teaching. God is jealous for our love. And he's jealous to see us become the people that he declares we are. Like any of us would feel about our children. We're jealous of the things that draw them away from who we want them to succeed to be. The good parent, the good spouse, the good employer or employee, the good person, the person that loves other people, the person that's willing to share his with others.
Yes.
Amen? And that's God. He wants us to fulfill our destiny. He wants us to grow up into his image, as it has been stated here already this morning. And he knows that the only way that's going to happen is through our relationship with him. And if our relationship with him is skewed, then every relationship that grows out of that our relationship with him is going to be screwed up too. So unless we can identify completely with God's acceptance and God's love for us and his freely giving us all things, we're never going to be able to influence others the way God intended us to. God doesn't care that his grace offends people, so you shouldn't either. I mean, some people just get mad, angry. But he doesn't care. He's not concerned if it offends people. He only cares that we have all of the grace that we need to be transformed into our Father's image, so that he can give us our inheritance, fulfill our destiny, so that we can bring others to their destiny, to their relationship with our Father.
Amen.
Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Have I bummed you out here this morning? God's good.
No.
It's all good.
Amen. It is.
And I tell you, we could have, right here, we've got, 17 people here. Not to mention the kids downstairs. 17 people. If each one of us could start our own religion, just based on what we know. Right? We could. Each one of us could go out and start another denomination. But if we all came to the same conclusion, we all come to the same understanding that this is all about us reaching our destiny, which is the fullness of the Godhead, the full stature of Jesus, really living out our lives in Christ, we could turn the world upside down. I'm telling you. Yes. You say, oh, come on. Come on. East side of Des Moines. No. It could happen.
Yes.
By multiplication. That's how they did it. That's how they did it in the first century. That's how Paul, that's how the disciples, that's what Jesus was doing.
Yep.
He loved the unlovable.
Yep.
He was despised by the religious because of his grace, because he was grace, because everywhere he went, he offered the love of God unconditionally.
Amen.
And each and every one of us can do it, regardless of IQ, regardless of financial statements, regardless of education, regardless of upbringing. Everybody can do this. That's why Jesus said it's a level playing field for everybody. It's God and his love.
Amen.
And then us responding. Praise the Lord. So, the next time you hear Carly Simon,
yeah.
That's me. I'm so vain, I know that song's about me. Praise the Lord. This is about Jesus. And he has called us illegitimate, despicable, unwanted, cast-offs to be his own beloved children,
yes.
In whom he's well pleased,
yes.
So that we can perpetuate the family of God, so that we can make everyone understand the goodness, the kindness, and the love of their Heavenly Father. Who's out looking? You see these orphanages all the time. Little kids wanting somebody to just break your heart. Obviously, that's why they do it, because they want some money. I get it. That's okay. Well, that's the same way we ought to be looking at everybody we come into contact with. That's another unwanted child. That's another abused child. That's another one that's been taken advantage of or discarded or uncared for. Amen? And God is saying, that's my child. Bring him home. Bring him back.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Absolutely.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
We're looking for love. The whole world is, however they want describe it or identify it, but it's just we have to get past that mindset. I'm going to finish. I'm just going to say this. A lot of the things that you see in churches today, okay, we've got, come as you are, which I'm totally cool with that. But, you know, there was a time, and a lot of churches, it's still that way. You know, there's a dress code,
yeah.
Spoken or unspoken. But, so now you have, all sorts of things. Just bear with me for a minute. So you've got people with dreadlocks, long hair, tats everywhere, totally illustrated men and women, and all kinds of other things. Not that there's anything wrong with any of that, but I'm saying we have pushed them to the forefront in a lot of churches, and the reason is because we're trying to send a message. But we never get to the message.
Right.
It becomes about, oh, that's the church where the people with tattoos go. Oh, that's the church where everybody wears shorts and tank tops. You understand what I'm saying? So, oh yeah, we can go there because they get out at 11. We can be on the golf course, but at 12. But it's never coming to the totality of what those things are representing is God's acceptance. God takes you just like you are. He doesn't care. You don't have to get all fixed. But we never get past that. It's about me. That's the church I want to go to because you can wear jeans. You know, where the women can wear halter tops. I don't know what it is, but, you know, everybody's got a thing. And instead of it being, we identify with the thing.
Right.
So, you know, yeah, we are what we are, but this isn't the end result isn't to get to a place where everybody's really comfortable. You know, well, this is a place where you can wear flip-flops there. It's about getting us to the place where it's not about us anymore, but it's actually about Him. Well, we're making Him the focus.
Amen.
So we do a lot of, you know, the peas under the shell, you know. It's that game. We're constantly shifting around and figure out where it's in Jesus.
Amen.
Period. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
See, that's why we do. All right, let's get them to have a victory march because y'all aren't really responding. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate you. God loves you. Share that love with anybody and everybody you get the opportunity to. That's the will of God for your life. Amen. God bless you. Go in the power of His love and His might. In Jesus' name. You're dismissed. God bless you all.